It's great to welcome to the program today David Sinclair, who's a professor of genetics at Harvard Medical School, as well as the author of the new book, Lifespan, Why We Age and Why We Don't Have to. David, so great to have you on today.
Hey, thanks, David. Thanks for having me on.
So we've interviewed folks like Aubrey de Grey and others, and everybody seems to apply sort of different language and vocabulary sometimes to talking about dealing with aging. There's the idea of curing aging. There's the idea of eliminating aging or making aging obsolete, as an example. Can you talk a little bit about sort of your general philosophy when it comes to the human lifespan and the sort of way you talk about and think about it?
Sure. Well, I'm not an immortalist. I'm a realist. I'm a scientist at Harvard Medical School, grounded in research we've been doing for over 25 years now. My view, though, is that by tackling the major cause of all diseases in our society, all major diseases, which is aging, we'll have a dramatic impact on those diseases and people's longevity and how young they can stay into the last 5, 10, 15 years of their lives.
And how much of the focus in your mind needs to be on, or I guess when we think about the approach that you take, is the idea to think about aging as a condition that we are looking to treat differently? Or is it more like, for example, when we talk about cancer treatment, we're really talking about a number of different conditions, each which needs or requires sort of a different approach depending on the particulars being not just the particulars of the condition, but also the particulars of the individual that we're looking to treat?
Well, about 10 years ago, the field that I'm in, longevity research, we declared that we had discovered the major hallmarks of aging. And these are things like mitochondrial dysfunction, so energy decline, stem cell depletion, telomere shortening. There's a group of them, and we were quite happy for those years, but I've always been fascinated in trying to find what's causing all of those, because they don't just happen. There has to be, in my view, a unifying reason, and that's what I think that I've come up with. This is my best explanation, and in the book, I describe much of the evidence that we've accumulated over 10 years. So what I think is causing all of those various hallmarks is a loss of information, the analog information in our cells. Now, what that means is that instead of having 5, 10, 20 different medicines to tackle each one of the hallmarks of aging, if I'm right, a single medicine could reverse the aging process.
And what is the sort of a physical way in which this operates? What is it specifically that is the process that you would be looking to either undo, stop, or actually reverse?
Yeah, well, only in the last few years we've realized that across all mammals, of course, including ourselves, there's what's called the DNA methylation clock. We also call it the Horvath clock, named after my friend Steve Horvath. And if I took your blood, Dave, I could read how old you are and even predict when you're going to die. And these marks are part of the epigenome. Now, we all know the genome very well, but the epigenome is the layer above that that regulates which genes are turned on and off. The epigenome is what allows us to go from a fertilized cell to a newborn of 26 billion cells, each tissue with thousands of different types of cells in there. The epigenome, I think, is what goes awry as we get older. We lose the epigenetic information, and that's the analog information of the cell. Now, anyone who's had a record player or a cassette tape knows that analog information is pretty useless at preserving information. And that, I think that's also true for our bodies. Now, the question is, can you find a backup copy of that epigenetic information to perform a reset of the cells? And I think we're coming very close to being able to do that. And we've already got some pretty interesting results in mice already.
What's the mechanism through which that could be done? Is it the delivery mechanism I'm talking about? Are we talking about a pill? Are we talking about nanotechnology, et cetera?
Yeah, well, it's early days. In fact, some of this work is not even published yet. Listeners can find this online. We've posted it. It's under peer review. there have been others who have published work that shows that you can also reset the clock. So how do we currently do it? Well, the first way it was done was to genetically modify mice. That's obviously not going to help. And that was also toxic the way it worked out. We've now packaged a set of three reprogramming genes that actually we use what are called Yamanaka factors, Yamanaka genes. Yamanaka won the Nobel Prize in 2012 for learning how to make stem cells out of skin cells and other adult cells in the body. But we use them to reset the clock in the body. We don't make stem cells. We push them partially back to where they came from. We deliver them, as you said, in a virus. Right now, it's a viral therapy. It would be used, we think, in the eye initially, which is where a lot of gene therapy is being applied in the clinic right now to correct genetic diseases. So we wouldn't be correcting genetic diseases necessarily. We'd be using it to rewind the clock and allow tissues and organs like the eye to recover and become more youthful. And in mice, at least, we've managed to restore eyesight in old mice.
What's the timeline that, understanding that it's still very early, that you think this may be developed on and available on?
Well, I'm an entrepreneur. Many people who know me know that very well. I've started many companies over the years. There's a new company that I'm working with Horvath, the friend I mentioned, a professor at UCLA, and myself and Professor Belmonte, who did the initial discovery that I mentioned about reprogramming. We've come together to make a go at this. We're going to be hopefully treating the first patient in less than 2 years from now. And our goal is to treat glaucoma, damage to the eye due to pressure. And we think that that'll be, if it works, the first of many treatments of turning back the clock in various parts of the body, and hopefully eventually throughout the entire body to have an age reset.
There are certain populations that have been studied for their longevity. So there are the Icarians, there are, you know, a number of these different populations that folks have heard of that live longer on average than others. Can you talk a little bit about whether in the work that you do, there is significance to that? My understanding is that much of their longevity is attributed to lifestyle. It seems as though your work is operating on a sort of different level. So do those populations have any research value to you, or are we really dealing with something very, very different?
No, actually, it all ties together. You know, if my theory didn't explain the last 100 years of observations, it wouldn't be a useful theory. So what we see and also predict, but what we currently see is that a stable epigenome, the ability to slow down that biological clock, does happen when societies and individuals have those healthy lifestyles, being hungry every day or every other day, doing a lot of exercise, keeping active, keeping the body in a state of high alert. These are the things that slow down that epigenetic clock that I believe is a driver, if not the main cause of aging itself. Now, there are also genes that we are either born of gene variants that we're born with, if we're lucky, that predispose to living over 100. These are called centenarian families. And the variants in those families are part of this epigenetic regulatory network. Some of them that we work on are called sirtuins, and the I in that sirtuin name stands for information. They're silent information regulators, and those are key players in this epigenetic clock. And we can use various things in our lives, such as what we eat, when we eat, and how much exercise we do, among other things I've put in my book, to slow down that rate of epigenetic clock ticking. There are many others that I talk about in my book and other things that can be done, but we think these are central regulators that are found throughout life and have been with us since the beginning of life.
Do you have a particular diet and or supplement regimen that you adhere to? And the reason I ask that is a lot of the folks that work in the field that you work in seem to have one, which sometimes is not obviously directly related to the research that the person seems to be doing. So it's more of a curiosity.
Mine's more than a curiosity. The work that we do in my lab can be translated into my family's lifestyle. and what we take. Of course, I don't recommend to my family that they take it, but they're all scientists and they know what the data suggests, and the risks far less than the potential reward. And so the first discovery that we made was that these sirtuin regulators of the epigenome need a molecule called NAD. And so that was back actually in 2002, 2003. So I take NAD boosting molecules that I am hoping and the evidence suggests will put my body in a state of high alert, as though I've been hungrier and exercising than I otherwise have time for. Resveratrol, this was in the news back in 2003. We discovered that resveratrol activates the sirtuin enzyme, which is a protector of the body and also a stabilizer of the epigenetic clock. And so resveratrol from red wine, I've been taking that, so has my father, for over a decade now. We both have very good health, and so far so good. I should say, by the way, because I'm a professor at Harvard Medical School, I know that this is not a clinical trial. It's not work that I'm going to publish. But I also know that we've all been born probably a generation or two too early to know for sure if these things work to extend healthy lifespan. And so we do have to be ahead of the curve if we're going to learn what these molecules are actually doing. That said, all of these molecules have been backed up by clinical trials that I'm also running, typically here at Harvard and also around the world. And we know the safety before any molecules are put into my body. And the last one we studied was metformin. We worked with Rafael DiCarbo at NIH to show that mice that are fed metformin, which is a diabetes drug, a reasonably safe one taken by millions of people around the world, that was ostensibly extended their lifespan, certainly kept them healthier. In human studies, it looks like in tens of thousands of patients that have been studied, metformin slows down the aging process, prevents cancer, heart disease, frailty, and of course, diabetes. And for that reason, I take a triple combo of those things.
Very interesting stuff. And I highly recommend that folks in the audience pick up the book Lifespan, Why We Age and Why We Don't Have to. We've been speaking with the book's author, David Sinclair, who's a professor of genetics at Harvard Medical School. David, really interesting having you on, and I so appreciate your time.
Thanks, David. I appreciate it too.